In an old paddling guidebook, Bruce Cockburn wrote, "There are still places in the world where the touch of humankind has been so light as to leave virtually no visible damage. Things look and feel as they must have when they were made. One of these areas is Canada's north. It is a subtle, rolling land of taiga and tundra, of muskox and wolverine. A land where the air is so clean that it is sweet to the taste, and where mosquitoes come in clouds too thick to clearly see through. Its stark beauty is profound, unforgiving, and terribly fragile. There is no room for error." At just over 600 miles from its headwater lakes to its triumphant exit into Hudson's Bay, the Thelon traverses continental North America's largest and most remote tract of wilderness. Described as probably one of the most varied wilderness canoe routes in the world, it offers an incredible variety of landscape and wildlife. This includes a unique oasis preserved as the Thelon Wildlife Sanctuary, where spruce trees struggle far into the Arctic and line the river. Productive habitat for thousands of muskox and caribou abounds. For the native Dene, the sanctuary is the place where God began. One question lingered. Do they reach the Thelon by the traditional and popular route over pikes, and then via the Hanbury River? After all, it was popular for a reason, quicker and easier. Or do they paddle the entire Thelon from its lake source? The Upper Thelon Country was well known to the indigenous First Nation peoples. When the first European explorers and trappers arrived, they learned from the local knowledge. In 1899, David Hanbury explored upstream from Hudson's Bay to what is now known as the Hanbury River. The following year, Tyrrell pushed further upstream to map up to the Elk River. The upper reaches were unknown to white men until the 1920s. Hjalmar Dahle, the partner and mentor for Hilga Ingstad, was probably the first European to travel the Thelon from its headwaters. In 1929, he constructed a canoe from willow and canvas and paddled from Lynx Lake to Baker Lake, thus completing all European explorations of the entire Thelon. The Roebuck expedition decided to follow this route, but for this leg, they had no scheduled endpoint. It was the Thelon proper. Longer, more remote, less traveled. They thought like Robert Frost. If two rivers diverged, take the one less traveled by. It made all the difference. After final provisioning in Yellowknife, they were ready to go. However, the worst fire season in recent history caused some delay. Dave Oleson, charter pilot, friend, author, homesteader, and all-around Renaissance man, was unable to fly through the smoke. They spent their first night as guests of the Hoarfrost Homestead, surrounded by beauty, huskies, friends, old and new.
Take me where the loons are calling, mist in the morning, smell of pine. Whiskey Jack, wake me up, send me out with a fishing line. Give me a canoe and let me go up past Waskasoo to the Wabanaw. Give me a canoe and let me go.
Finally, a return to their old campsite on Lynx Lake.
So So we had reached the Thielen at last. Here lay the woodland bordering the great unknown lakes, from which the Thielen set out on its long journey through the wilderness. Far, far away, where the river pours its mighty waters into Hudson Bay, train oil lamps were flickering in igloos, and slant-eyed men were hunting the seal with harpoons. Here, on the banks of its upper reaches, stood the sons of the forests, the Indians, scanning the horizon for caribou. Helge Ingstad.
Just arrived Lynx Lake. I kind of recognize this place, Craig and I. It's Monday, I believe it's July 31. This is the golf course. And we just got, after two tries, getting out and going east from Great Slave to this particular spot where we had camped for several days in 2019. So now we're back.
For 4 years, I lived as a trapper in the isolated region northeast of Great Slave Lake. I had decided to realize a dream that had always been with me. A primitive life in northern, practically uncharted wilds, and a region where the lives of the natives still largely followed their ancient traditions. The wilderness northeast of Great Slave Lake proved to be what I had been looking for. Helge Ingstad.
To the natural features of the country, it would be difficult for any writer to do justice. They require the artist's pencil rather than the pen of a wanderer. The photographs will give the untraveled reader but a poor idea of the character of the country, which for many years has, with scant justice, been called the barren ground. The Northland must be lived in to be understood and appreciated, for its constantly changing aspect baffles description. David Hanbury.
I know it's morning. I think it's day 4. How we doing up there, bro?
06:30. August 3rd.
Here we are at Camp 4.
Yes, sir.
And there is the ship owner navigator trying to figure out how the hell we get out of this lake and find a river.
I beg to differ. You are perhaps the ship owner now, but we'll see. About 15 miles today. It was on and off rain, but all in all, the best day we've had so far.
Yep. Early morning start.
Its headwaters are unknown. They have forever been veiled in mystery. It is known, of course, that the Caribou Eater Indians annually make long journeys by dog sled to the Upper Thielen, but they jealously guard the secrets surrounding this part of the country. Word had been spread abroad concerning a tract of forest growing about several large lakes in the very heart of the barren lands. Helge Ingstad.
Morning, day 5?
Yeah, August 4th. 5:30 in the morning. Thank you.
26, wind is back, sun is gone. We start the Thelon. Upper Thelon, fishing break, because we're hungry.
It's supposed to be a diet tour.
Not a suffer fest. It's one of the big eskers.
So where are we, Roebuck?
Lunch stop. First river lunch stop. First forest.
Yep.
Perfect spot.
Portage number one, because in a different age, we would probably run that. But since we've got conservative in our, wiser and more conservative in our days, we portaged. And we did it so smart, we had a camp in the middle. So we only have to do this once. Three loads. First portage, doing it the second half after breaking camp.
Not a bear, but the muskox. This reminds me of Pike's Portage. Unique. Now we know what a muskox smells like.
Lot of lake paddling. How we doing, bro?
Good. Getting tired of lake paddling. We got tricked.
Suckers.
The Upper Thelon can be more accurately described as a chain of lakes. Its inlets and outlets are hidden in a maze of intricate bays and coves. Armed with modern maps, today's adventurers can benefit from the hard-earned experience of the first white trappers and explorers who relied on birds, trees, and trial and error to find their way to these outlets. When a single channel does exist, the river often acts like a lake.
This is Monday morning, noonish, lunch break before P2, which was Portage 2 on our map, but it's our third portage.
Everything back in boat.
I got my Sherpa. What portage is this?
Just the bare essentials.
Yes. This is the Big Bend on Big Rock Point Camp. 1 kilometer portage. And once again, unique is the forecast today is sun, and 70 degrees.
So I think because of that, I have a little gift for the brother.
This will scare the bugs away. Oh,
that's right, and the bears.
It's a little small.
Not bad. We're going to have a nice day on the river and sunshine today.
I can taste it, I swear. Take me somewhere sunny and 75.
We having fun yet?
The portage. It was a defining characteristic of the trip. In all, there were 6 portage locations before the big one at the Thelon Canyon. Fortunately, none of these was over 1 mile in length, but because of the need to shuttle multiple bags, each expedition member walked 15 miles with gear. On occasion, an overnight camp could be made on a portage route, thus breaking up work and saving on bag drags. Could there be a few less portages? Yes, but due to the low water level and the high conservatism level, safety triumphed over youthful exuberance.
Second portage of the day. The day being number 9. And there's no way through that ledge. Ledge. What's cooking, good looking?
3-course meal.
Yeah.
Potatoes, sweet potatoes, onions.
And vegetables.
Oh, sorry, vegetable. 4-course. And then we're going to spice it up with a little bit of garlic. Unfortunately, we don't have protein fish.
And what's missing? Protein fish.
That's okay.
It's the first actual portage trail we've actually come across. Morning, day 10. Starting off with a 1/4 mile portage.
Morning.
Last one for a couple days. There's the rock garden we avoided. We're finally shoving off for more lake battling. Lake Thelon, as we like to call it. View from the knoll. At Camp 10, current camp. Several evenings been watching Jaegers fly around.
Early explorers, trappers, biologists alike all recognize the uniqueness of the Thelon Oasis. Fearing the extermination of the two remaining muskox herds in North America, there were calls for the government to establish a sanctuary to preserve the muskox and other residents as early as 1900. In 1927, those efforts bore fruit as the Thelon Game Sanctuary was created for the conservation of wildlife. Expanded in 1956, it remains Canada's largest wildlife refuge.
I dream of a wild forest. It seems to call my name. So green, it goes forever. Never settled, never tame. There runs wild a river, so calm along the shore. It whispers, please come hither, come wander me once more. So when the sun is rising, strong to melt the snow, I gather pack and paddle, and north away again I go. May I find the wild forest, may I find the quiet shore. If I find they all escape me, may I search forevermore.
Foraging is fun.
Elk River Rest Stop. A chance to fish, hike up to Granite Falls, and try out the pack raft. Also, a psychological milestone. This is as far upstream as J.W. Tyrrell explored in 1900. From here, it seemed as if the Thelon was all going to be discovered country. Thus ended the little documented and rarely visited Upper Thelon. Fitting that here is where the only other human beings were sighted on the entire trip.
Here's our camp at Elk River. I'm going fishing today for the nth time. There's Elk River, and there's Craigo. While I'm fishing and quartermastering,
I'm going on a massive 1 to 1.5 mile hike up to the falls and paddle down.
All right. And the falls are called?
Granite Falls.
All right.
Because I didn't get enough water.
Miles from nowhere. Guess I'll take my time. Oh, yeah. To reach there, look up at the mountain I have to climb. Oh, yeah. To reach there, Lord, my body has been a good friend, but I won't need it when I reach the end. Miles from nowhere, guess I take my time. Oh yeah, to reach the end.
hole inside. Oh yeah, but it's all right.
Got a little bit of practice in, it's fun.
I have my freedom. I can make my own rules. Oh yeah.
So where did you paddle us to today?
Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, sure looks like it.
Just saw the camel go over. A camel and
I took my paddle and we began the tough return journey against the current. Somewhere it must all be recorded, as insects are captured in amber. That day on the river. Transcribed in Brule water, written on the autumn air. Safe, at least, in my memory. Stirling North.
I'm going fishing. Collecting firewood. Another little esker over there. Double Barrel Lake. Another esker.
Oh.
What's today? First fish day.
First fish day? Cheers.
Cheers.
We had one fish 5.4 kilos, 1.1 meter long. The other one was 4 kilos and 85 centimeters long. All right.
In honor of your first fish.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
We were here delayed by wind for a couple of days. Paddling against a headwind, be it ever so light, is slow work. Against a steady breeze, no headway at all can be made, and it is a waste of energy to attempt it. David Hanbury.
Still stuck on double barrel.
Forest fire smoke is still ravaging Canada. It's coming our way from the west. Just smoke on the western horizon.
I have always maintained that barren ground is a misnomer for the Northland of Canada. No land can be called barren, which bears wildflowers in profusion, numerous heaths, luxuriant grass in places up to the knee, and a variety of moss and lichens. It is barren only in the sense that it is destitute of trees, hence the name De Chin Ule, no trees, which is the Indian name for it. David Hanbury.
Glorious were these bright autumn days. I rambled about wherever I chose, and nothing required me to hurry. If my fancy prevailed upon me to sit down on some hillside for a rest and a quiet smoke, I did so. If it crossed my mind to climb a ridge far off in the distance for the sake of the vista which lay beyond, I did so. Should evening close in on me before I knew it, I would simply make a fire, roast some meat on a spit, and sleep right where I was. Helge Ingstad.
Day 16, third day windbound. Going nowhere in this crap.
Day 4.
I have almost failed to note the passage of time. One day has drifted into the next, and the spirit of the wilderness has filtered into my manner of thinking. My monotonous existence, whether in camp or en route to some distant point, has become normal for me, and all there was of my life prior to my sojourn in the wilds has drifted off into a distant haze, permitting me but occasional faint remembrance of those once proud realities. Helge Ingstad.
One of the advantages of having no set schedule or takeout point is that being windbound is not worrisome or stressful. Enjoy each day as it is. Revel in beauty. Sleep. Go hiking. Fish.
Here we go, day 4, waiting on weather. We have meandered over to the Spruce Grove, which is, I don't know, a bit downwind from us to get protected, and
reindeer soup.
It's reindeer soup from Finnmark. There you go. We're going to be eating like kings tonight.
Night paddling. It's the usual solution to avoid the wind. However, this late in the season, and at this latitude, it was too dark to safely travel between 11 p.m. and 3 a.m., thus limiting opportunities to move during calmer winds. At times, they were on the water just before sunrise. At times, they paddled into the falling night.
Day 18, I think. Coming through the narrows. Very happy to be in the river again.
Yeah.
Here's an old paddle that's well worn. Pile of firewood that's been brought in here, spruce roots. And then there's a bucket with a wire, hanging wire lid on it. So this is obviously something that was related to Bodie Olson's time. It's right near our tent location.
Here we are, windbound yet again.
Waiting on weather.
The Sodoku master rules. And it's blowing about 25 knots out there.
Beyond a bend in the river, we came upon the first human habitation I had seen in days. I experienced a shock of recognition that was almost uncanny, as though I had lived here in a previous life. And yet, I had never seen anything like this big cabin with its green lawn sloping to the water. If Rascal and I were determined to live in the woods, here was the home we wanted. Sterling North.
Welcome to the trapper's cabin from Mr. Bodie and Mr. Olson from the 1920s fur trapping craze.
Yeah.
Thanks to David Olson, we found it because he's the one who discovered it. And pretty small as the cabins were, this was 1920s, right?
Late 1920s.
Pots and pans, 12 by 16-ish.
Yeah, rectangular?
Yeah.
Yeah. But what is interesting, it looks like he didn't make a traditional log cabin, though it was split.
Yeah, there's not much left of it, but easily recognizable.
Yeah.
There's a cache, maybe, or...
A lot of history and a lot of sadness here because he was murdered. But he never came back.
That was the end.
Yeah. We're going to get a better story from Dave Olson when we get our pickup, get more details. He's writing a book about it.
The expedition visited the remains of an old trapper cabin built by Emil Bodie and Gene Olson, last used in 1930. It was, however, more of a pilgrimage to honor these frontiersmen. Bodie and Olson were brutally murdered in their beds. Their bodies were not discovered until about 10 months later. The RCMP removed the remains and buried them on site. To this day, the murders are unsolved. Prayers were said and whiskey shared.
The final resting place of trappers Bodie and trapper Olson. A few hundred feet from the cabin.
The waypoint.
Pretty sad. Yes, considering they were brutally murdered in their sleep. There's one of them.
Yeah. I don't want to move this.
No, don't move anything.
Yeah.
Here's the other one. Heading back. Got a rain shower coming through. Just a little bit of wind.
It seemed a miracle that anything as young as fingerling trout or grouse chicks or my small raccoon could move along this watercourse among boulders as old as the world, the new life of this very season, amid granite predating even the first life on the globe. Sterling North.
First one took, but we got red wine, Arctic grayling, vegetables, and happy fisherman.
Yeah.
Still day 22, just south of Mary Frances River, through the rock gardens.
There he is.
Night. Candid camera. Just went through a class two in the ledge.
And we're all good. And we're still dry.
We're still dry.
End of day 22, setting up camp right at sunset.
Sometimes it's worth all the pain and bugs, and this is why.
Yeah, we're getting a good sunset tonight.
And a good evening. 3 hours of paddling, 15 miles.
Made some good time.
Sundown, Monday. Thelon. Just did 15 miles until it was too dark to paddle. Too dangerous if we go no further into the night. This is 9 o'clock at night.
One of the advantages of night paddling, you get to see the night wildlife.
Amazing. What a place. That is a good omen.
That is. We may have to change the name of the camp from Mary Frances to Owl's Head.
One loses sense of time in the woods, I had no watch and could only guess at the hour of the day by looking at the sun. I'd even forgotten what day it was, and it certainly didn't matter. No school bell or church bell rang to remind us of the dutiful passage of time. One day blended into the next, and could only be remembered as the day we saw the porcupine or the day we found Lost Lake. Sterling North.
Day 23. Approaching Iberry Lake. And the big sand flats.
Lunch break. Keith and Ingen's 43rd anniversary day, August 23, 2023. A little creek. Nice drinking water. Little panorama here. I think for the first time on this entire trip, we've got absolutely no clouds. And lunch break.
We have officially crossed the 1927 boundary of the Thelon Game Sanctuary here.
One more milestone. Tick the box.
As the Hunchback of Notre Dame says,
this is the evening of 23 August. Just made camp. It's almost wind still. We have not had this situation on our trip yet.
I thought it over after I went to bed. That is the best time to think things out. I came to the conclusion that I wasn't born for city life, and that I was glad of it. It's nice to eat ice cream at brilliant restaurants at 11 o'clock at night once in a while, but as a regular thing, I'd rather be in the East Gable at 11, sound asleep, but kind of knowing, even in my sleep, that the stars were shining outside and that the wind was blowing in the firs across the brook. Anne Shirley.
One day, the expedition received news of a family medical issue back home. Fortunately, there were unlimited options for landing sites along or beside the river, so pace and campsite selection kept the boys at the ready. Perhaps it was a sign, if not a subtle one, a brilliant display of northern lights ushered in their last day in the field. After 25 days and 200 miles on the river, in the place where God began, it was time to go home.
So one morning, just as the sun is coming up, I stand in front of my tent and look about me for the last time. My clump of spruces stand nodding a friendly farewell from their hollow. In the treetops, the squirrels are chattering after my vanishing form. On the sunny slopes, the hares are sitting in pairs And down in the osier thicket, the ptarmigan are perched on the leafless bushes like fabulous white fruits. Crossing the lake, I find one doe and her calf idling. They do not move in their tracks, merely turn their heads and stare with a look of surprise in their large eyes. Here too is a last farewell. Helge Ingstad.
Fresh and strong, the summer skies are blue, and 'tis joy to float along.
Perhaps the time has come, and there probably will never come days such as those we have spent together. God knows why I should move on when I have everything I want right here, but it can't be helped. Restlessness is a stir in my blood, and I must give into it. And then we shall head due south. Helge Ingstad.
Nothing is easy in the north. After a marathon 3-hour and 20-minute flight, the expedition landed in the eerily abandoned city of Yellowknife. It was evacuated under threat of fire and smoke, so they stayed the night in the backyard of a gracious family. The only way out was a government charter evacuation flight the following day.
After supper, Anne sat before the fire between Matthew and Marilla and gave them a full account of her visit. "I've had a splendid time," she concluded happily. "And I feel that it marks an epoch in my life. But the best of it all was the coming home."
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Come on, brothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, fathers, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, fathers, let's go down, down in the river to As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the